Hi, I'm Ford Hallam, and you're watching my Japanese metalwork channel and sometimes goldsmithing channel. Right, first things first, at the beginning of the month, on episode 8A, I think it was, I promised to give away five chisels that I'd made in the course of teaching. Here they are, all beautifully honed and polished up, looking pretty. The two that weren't hardened are now hardened and tempered. So we said, make a comment on Patreon on that particular post notification. There are, as of today, the 11th of September, 12:40 p.m., 34 comments. So we've gone on to the interwebs, that's for a drum roll, a handy website, random.org, which generates random numbers using background noise. We could do it in this house. There's so much background noise, but I don't know how to get the numbers out. Anyway, so I've put in a minimum range of 1 to 34. And so here we go. Drum roll, please. Generate the first number. Is number 15. Right, so comment number 15. Second one is, number 2. Someone's in early. And the third one, 9. Another early commenter. The fourth one, number 33. Someone in the tail end. And the last one, a 3. Oh, goodness me, 2 and 3. Oh, well, that's the nature of random numbers. I will go on now and let you know who are going to receive these chisels. I will send you private messages to get your addresses, and they'll be in the post. But don't despair. We've got some more giveaways. When I'm done with this, I'll talk about them. Back to you. Right, welcome back. We've had a look on the list of comments. And here we go with our lucky winners this month. The first number was number 15. So what we did was I ignored Bella's comments. And if anybody did more than one comment, I skipped that. So everybody had a fair one go, excepting Bella, of course. But she steals my chisels anyway. She does. So the first draw was number 15. And that was Doug Szymanski. Szymanski, I beg your pardon. Doug Szymanski. Who will get another mention shortly because he's got a question I've got to answer in a little while. Number 2 was Johan Svanberg. Number 9 was Michael Day. Hi, Michael. Number 33 in France, lucky lady, Nancy Work. And number 3 up in Manchester, I think you are, Lee Donahay. So the five of you, if you could actually message me, in fact, that'll help me, send me your postage. Lee, I've already got yours, I think, because I'm sending you some raccoon pelt, you weirdo. So that's that lot. Right. I'm going to randomly select these later and send them to you at my own expense, because, you know, that's how nice we are. Next month, next one's giveaway will be the Ginko inlay exercise I've been doing in this film. So this particular piece. This will go to the first draw. Put your comments below this film on Patreon, right? Only on Patreon. If you're on YouTube, you don't get a look in. You've got to be on Patreon. Put a comment there. This is the finished piece when it's done and patinated. So that'll be number 1. I might even sign it if I love you lots. The second prize will be this piece, which was done sometime in a class in America by myself. Obviously, it's not quite as refined as that one, but it does require a bit more carving. You can either choose to finish it yourself or just keep it as a study piece. And the third prize, the booby prize, but in fact actually might be even more useful, is the piece we did for episode 6A that went missing. So this is the repeat of that exercise. So you've got a ginkgo leaf in shibuichi cut out, filed up, and the start of the lip raised. So that's number 3. So that will be at the end of this month, September. So all comments on the end of this video, please, on Patreon. And I'm going to try, as I think I said before, to have a giveaway every month. Next month, possibly some polishing stones and charcoal and so forth. Little packages of tester material for you. We've got a couple of questions to deal with. Right, so in answer to some questions, Doug Szymanski asked, I'm going to just simply quote, it's easiest way. This may be a foolish question, but here goes. There are no foolish questions. There might be foolish answers, but that's me. This may be a foolish question, but here goes. When something is chased, it work hardens the metal. Correct. So should it be annealed before using a scraper to finish the surface, or should it be used work hardened? Second, using a chisel to create the design, does it stay in an annealed state for using the scraper? I'm not quite sure about the second question, but I'll start with the first one and we'll try and elaborate. You really want, especially with copper, copper in particular, to leave the metal in as hard a state as you can. Obviously not like hardened steel. Copper is very gummy, it's very sticky. And in a fully annealed state, scraping it is a bit like trying to scrape icing sugar on a cake. So really, if it's work hardened, it's a little bit more crisp and you'll find it a little bit more easy to control. The same with fine silver, which is ridiculously soft, as is gold. That little bit of work hardening does help. So in general, with the non-ferrous alloys, you want to work it as hard as you can, really. So don't anneal. With the chiseling, you're not really going to harden the metal very much from chiseling at all. There'll be very minute surface compression. And what I actually find, especially particularly with the fine wrought iron I use, when I chisel, I get a very bright surface where I move on. There's obviously an impact. The flat of the chisel is pressing down on the metal. So in effect, it's almost burnishing as it goes. So it is compressed, so there is work hardening. But in the morning, the day after, the metal has relaxed a little bit and the surface is a little less bright. So that initial hardening can relieve itself, I think. That's my experience anyway. So I don't think you need to worry about chiseling imparting any significant structural change to the surfaces with regard to finishing. So just to recap, you want to do your scraping work when the metal's hard. That probably applies to polishing also. Soft metal in a fully annealed state is going to be a little bit more gummy. And so it's going to drag a little bit, the metal can deform and so forth. So again, there you would rather have it hard. There are one or two exceptional circumstances where you would anneal, but they're very specific. And at some point down the line in this education I'm giving you as an apprentice here in my workshop with me, we'll get to it. Right, I'll have a look if there's another question. Right, so this wasn't a question on Patreon. I think it was a message somebody sent me on Instagram, and it's a pertinent one. It's perhaps a little premature for now, but it's relevant, so I'll cover it. How do we get rid of the pitch off the back of the piece once you've taken out the pitch? You could, of course, heat it up, burn it off, but then you've annealed the whole piece, which really isn't ideal because you're going to distort metal, perhaps. You've got inlays, and it's not really good practice to anneal a piece that's got inlay work already done. Because things can expand, metals can distort, and most significantly, of course, everything is then soft. The structure of your piece is soft. So we don't really want to use heat if we can avoid it. So I use a solvent. I tend to use lacquer thinners. I know it's very volatile and it's not good for your brain. It's too late for me. So obviously use it outside, dissolve it all off, scrub it off. I recycle the stuff until it's just a brown sludge. The important thing then is to boil it in hot water, because some of the residual thinners or cellulose thinners may remain trapped underneath the inlays. In fact, it's almost inevitable with some of the pitch. And then, of course, when you're patinating in boiling rock shaw, that residue may bubble out and you'll have a hell of a mess on your hands. So you really want to boil it out in hot water, get it as clean as possible. So that's what I tend to do. You can use paint stripper as an alternative. You can just paint it on the back and then lift it off. You've got less issue there of the paint stripper getting in underneath the inlay. Or if it's just a small amount, paint stripper works. Same thing applies. The fumes and so forth are pretty noxious. I use a product here in the UK called Nitromorse, which is truly devil snot. It's evil stuff, but it's very, very effective. I used to use the brown tin, which is good for old varnishes and so forth. I think they discontinued that because it dissolves babies as well. So there's a yellow tin in the UK. It's very effective. I dare say there are similar things in the United States, but with obviously baby oil, because, you know, I know the, in the colonies, they're all a little bit risk averse. Oh. Anyway, that's that. Now moving on to episode 9B, how to polish with stones and stuff. Recording. Right, so here we are. Some very basic aspects of fine metal polishing. A lot of the work I do in the sink. I have a little board that I put across the sink, so I've got running water. However, if you're working on your bench and you're doing little bits of fine finishing, you're going to need at least a bowl of water. Absolutely essential, because that's integral to all of the polishing processes. Paper towel, really helpful, because you need to wipe things off, or you can have a towel on your lap and keep yourself covered in mud. This is a helpful little wooden stand to work on, and you're probably hoping that there's a Japanese name for it. Of course there is. This is a togi dai. Togi meaning to polish, and a dai means a platform. So it's helpful, you can work on that. It contains as a relatively small amount of water. You could even hollow that out a little bit if you wanted to get fancy. But there is something else. This is a togi ban, which is a polishing tray. It's just a piece of sea dry hollowed out, lacquered. It helps contain the water. So you need something like that. You could use a little tray, of course, anything that can contain the water, because water and metal tools are not good friends. So that's the first step. Now, let's talk about the kinds of materials we're going to need. Right, so I'm going to start off by describing the classical or traditional process as it was practiced in the past, to the best of my knowledge. Once you've done all your carving and your scraping, and we are talking almost exclusively about non-ferrous metal work here, the metal surface would be refined with a stone. These stones are typical of what would be used. This is a variety of Nagura. I think it's called a Tsushima do. It's a very fine-grained, hard gray stone. Japanese sword polishers use these also. They're a little finer than Scotch stone, a little harder. They don't wear quite as fast. But that's what my teacher and his colleagues were using when I first went to Japan 20 years ago. So that's used to refine. So that's the Nagura stone. Then you'd move on to two varieties of charcoal. Now, the traditional charcoals that used are honoki and kirinoki. Honoki is magnolia wood charcoal. That's quite soft and it cuts very quickly. But with all charcoals, of course, you have to select them very carefully. Individual pieces can vary quite a lot, depending on the age of the wood and the part of the tree, in fact. So if you do make some, or you manage to get some from Japan, it's not particularly expensive and it's light, so it's worth perhaps getting some. You need to be quite selective about picking your pieces for your fine polishing. They're not like modern materials where you can just, you know, work away and know that it's going to be uniform. It's a natural product. So magnolia charcoal would follow the Nagura, and then you'd finish with a very fine-grained kirinoki, Paulownia wood. Now, I actually very rarely use Paulownia to finish, but it's nice to have it to hand, especially when working with gold and silver. It really does help to bring up a beautiful fine finish. Once you finish with these solid materials, you would move on to a powder abrasive. And I will touch on those in a separate video, because the powder materials are quite difficult in their application, really. And I'm going to recommend that we use more readily available substitutes in the West, which I'll get to in a moment. So when I returned from Japan, this was a long time ago, before the internet was really a thing, and ordering things from abroad was a lot more complicated. I had to find a substitute for the Nagura stone, and as a goldsmith, I was very familiar with Scotch stone, which of course silversmiths and jewelers had used for 200 years in the European tradition. And so this is Scotch stone. Some of you may know it. it's become very difficult to get hold of nowadays because the mine flooded and production has stopped. So this is old commercial stock. I still have a fairly good stock, so I'll be using this until I die. And I may bequeath some to the rest of you. This is some free range stuff that was recovered from the river. As you can see, it's very similar. In fact, it is the same stuff. There are slightly different grain structures, but it's effectively a faster, slightly more coarse version of the Japanese Nagura stone. When I introduced this stone to my teacher and his colleagues, they were quite enamored of it. And so I used to send little parcels to Japan. I have to say, I slightly regret that now. I wish I'd have kept them all. But, you know, you've got to be generous, open-hearted. So that's what, if you do get hold of some of this stuff, grab it, although sometimes the prices are ridiculous. So the search has been on for a reasonable substitute. And here I have to thank Mac McKinnon down in New Zealand. Mr. Mac suggested some time ago that he use an alternative. In fact, the King brand 800 grit stone. These are about £20. It's a fair sized brick of synthetic abrasive stone. These are made primarily for Japanese style woodworkers for sharpening chisels and plane blades. It's an 800 grit. I slice it up using a tile saw. There's a fair bit of waste, but I don't have a lapidary saw working at the moment. So this is what it produces. The finish is, to be frank, compared to Nagura and Scottish stone, a little coarser, but it does work. And as you can see, it adapts to form fairly quickly. So it's quite soft, which is really an important aspect of what we need these stones to do. I will demonstrate the use of this in a minute, because really, Nagura you can get hold of from Japan, and I would strongly recommend, if you are serious about getting into this, get hold of a couple of pieces. It may cost you a bit, but they do last a while. But this is really, at the moment, I think, your most practical option. I've been spoiled with my stones, but I have used some of this, and it is, in fact, brilliant on iron and steel. So, you know, if you are making suba and so forth, this is the stuff you want to use anyway. So we'll get to this. So this is where we're at in terms of substitute for Scotch stone for that first stage of polishing and refining form after very fine scraping. Now, I mentioned the Nagura stone, of course. This is a synthetic Nagura stone that I've sliced up. It's made by the Matsunaga Stone Company in Japan. And these are made, again, as I say, synthetic, to create a slurry on your very fine polishing stones. You find when you get to 6,000 or 8,000 grit stones, it's very difficult to get a slurry because the stone is so fine. So you rub some of this on and it helps build up a bit of a mud. They are quite fine. They're significantly finer than these. So once you've used the 800 grit synthetic stone, you could go on to this as a finish before you go on to charcoal. So that's an option. And this is where I'm going to suggest that you have to do some experimentation depending on the metals you're working with. I think it always was thus. You've got to experiment to find out what you've got available. I've got a drawer full of stones that various people have sent me. Tian Berger in Pretoria in South Africa sent me a bundle of stones from the felt that have some promise. As we go along and other stones come to light, of course, we'll share that with you. Another little stone worth noting is actually what was used as a pencil. That's a little stub of it. These were sold on eBay. It's a form of slate, obviously. As Civil War pencils. I don't know what the Civil War has to do with it, but suffice to say, they're 19th century, used for writing on slate boards in schools. It's a very fine slate. I think I paid $100 for 100 pieces. I'll include some of those in a giveaway. They're very fine grained. They do crumble occasionally on the tip, which makes for a coarse bit of grit, which can scratch. But if you use it carefully, you can almost get a polish on non-ferrous metals. So I occasionally use this because it is hard and I can shape it to a very fine point and I can get into tiny delicate areas. I've even been known to use this polishing around gemstones that I've set. It's quite handy to have. You can pick them up, as I say, for about $1 a piece. You may have to buy a few more, but then you could give all of your metalworking friends a couple for Christmas and they'll love you or just be bemused. So that's an example of finding something and giving it a go and discovering that it does work. One final aspect of abrasive stones to talk about are the synthetic stones manufactured for die making and engineering and so forth. The company I've used most of all is Gesswein in America, and they make, this is an example of one of their stones. This is a aluminium oxide stone, if memory serves, designed for polishing things like aluminium and copper. They say that. I wouldn't like to have to do all of my work using this stuff. It works very nicely on iron and steel and harder metals, but it does have a tendency to crumble. It's a little bit friable, and those crumbly bits then become bits of grit, which drag in the metal and create quite ugly scratch marks. I'm not a great fan of the finish it leaves. It's a little bit, it looks a little bit sandblasted, to be frank. They're very soft, but I would suggest though that you get a couple. They're not particularly expensive, and experiment. The finer they are, the perhaps more useful they are. That's a 1200 grit. Again, much more useful on iron and non-ferrous. And of course they come in a variety of grits and shapes. So that's an area to explore. But I have to say, from my perspective, I've not really enjoyed using these things. The only time I do use them, and then it will be much coarser ones, it'll be in shaping steel or polishing steel. For the non-ferrous metal, I'm trying to stick to natural materials or something very close. So that's that in terms of materials. Right, so now I'm going to try and demonstrate what each of these stones, inverted commas, and charcoal do on metal. This is a piece of what we'd call half-hard rolled copper, as to say it's not fully annealed, it's not fully hard, and this will hopefully simulate the surface that a lot of you will be working on. So I'm going to start with the natural Tsushima dough, the natural Nagura stone, the dark grey one. A little bit of water. Not pressing too hard. If you press too hard, you stop yourself developing a nice slurry and you end up burnishing the metal. And your stone gets glazed. You know you're pressing too hard if you get metal on the stone and you get little sort of glazed parts. Your mud should build up and that grey should eventually go purple because it's picking up some of the copper. So I'm just going to do a nice little area. I'm going to do this with each stone and hopefully we can see some sort of difference on the camera. It's terribly difficult to show. So when I work a plate, I like to work the edges. I'm not going to be too fastidious here, but work the edges to make sure you don't miss those parts. The stone will conform to the plate. I think that might give us, and I hope you can see it's a relatively light amount of pressure I'm putting on. I'm going to rinse that. The tissue comes into play. So that's the Tsushima dough, the natural Nagura stone. But the next stone I'm going to use is the water of air stone, the Scotch stone, just so you have a comparison. And I'll do it alongside it. Sometimes when you start with the natural stone, the outer face sometimes feels a little hard. It takes a moment to bite and build up a slide. There it is. I'm trying to do this in real time so you get a real sense of how long it takes to achieve the finish. So I'm not going to do too much. So that's your Scotch stone. Very similar. But there is a subtle difference. Now, curiously enough, although the Nagura stone is harder and a finer stone, the Scotch stone being softer, the particles being softer also, the particles of the Scotch stone break down. So actually, you're able to get a slightly finer finish. I dare say the same is true of Nagura were I to go much more softly again, but this, it's more rapid with the Scotch stone. So now I'm going to try the synthetic 800 grit King stone that I sliced up. Again, a bit of water. And you can see it's immediately a little bit more skatey. Taking a while to build up some slurry, but it's cutting pretty quick. So the stone is reluctant to break down. That's, I suppose, because it's designed to sharpen steel, harden steel. A little bit of slurry building up now. Pretty quick, it's in its action. Really very aggressive actually, really feeling it bite quite strongly. So you wouldn't have to have a heavy hand when using this. Wow, that really does bite. Okay. So there's that one. You can see it's quite matte. It looks whitish because of the way the metal's been scoured. But it's a fine, even finish. Right, so now I'm going to try the synthetic Nagura. This is the one that's used for providing some slurry on very fine polishing stones. And let's see how we get on with this. Doing very little to start. It's just rubbing the edges. It's quite a bright finish. Quite fine. The stone's got to break, and then they're quite brittle. So again, synthetic stone's not providing a great amount of slurry to start, but it is very fine. It's not an unpleasant feeling on the metal. Quite a bright finish, which suggests that the particles are quite sharp and quite hard. It's not particularly abrasive. It hasn't really got, well, it's fine, obviously. But compared to the Nagura, the natural Nagura, which quite readily got rid of all of the fine rolling marks, they're still here, on here. Much brighter, as you can see. Much finer. So it would take a bit more work, but you'd end up with a much finer finish. So again, it's one of those stones you've got to look at and go, okay, is this going to work for me? Is this going to do what I need in these circumstances?
with your level of carving ability and so forth. All of those things you may want to consider. And this is also on copper. So we don't know what it's going to be like exactly on fine silver, on shakado, on shibuichi or brass. So as you can see, we have all these variations in the effect of the stones themselves, the materials we're using. Then you have to factor in the material. And of course, oftentimes you're using more than one metal. So this is why sometimes those questions that you hope have a single answer, sorry to disappoint you, it all depends, doesn't it? Right, so the effect there is not unpleasant, very fine. I think that has its place. What I like is that it doesn't crumble and create grit that's going to scratch. That little scratch that you can perhaps see there, that was in fact in the metal already. I wouldn't have expected that to remove it because, as we've discovered, it's a very fine grit, much finer than the natural Nagura. That leaves quite a bright finish. I'm also just doing one direction, of course, and directly onto the rolled copper plate. What you'd usually be doing is using a coarse stone, a finer stone, and a yet finer stone, and so forth, and changing direction every time to obliterate the previous lines. So what I'm trying to do, though, is just show a comparative effect of the stones. So as you can see, they are all quite distinct in the effect they deliver. Right, and the last of the stones, another synthetic one. This is a Gesswein 1200 grit, I think aluminium oxide, designed for copper, aluminium, soft metals. This is what was recommended when I contacted them about a substitute. So let's give this a go. As I said, I'm not a fan of the coarser grits, but the 1200 may yet serve us. So quite readily builds up a slurry, but the slurry feels oddly dryish, which is mad because it's wet, clearly. It's as though the stone is a bit of a sponge. And wants to absorb all of the water. It doesn't, but it just feels like that to me. It's very grippy. So what that is, I think, I can't prove it scientifically, but I think it's because the actual particles that are the abrasive, the aluminium oxide particles, are very sharp and they're very hard. And so they get embedded in the copper. It doesn't seem to be a problem when it comes to patination. Things like that, but it really does bite. As you can see, there's a really good slurry, and the stone conforms very rapidly, which is why these are favoured by die makers and machinists and so forth for fine finishing. As I say, it works. The 1200 grit, the very fine one, works relatively well on metal, and I use copper as my test because copper is probably one of the more difficult metals to polish by hand compared to shibuichi and brass and shakada and so forth, because it is quite soft and gummy. So if anything's going to catch and gall or drag across it, it'll happen in copper. So if copper can be polished well, it's a good test. Now here we go. That's a pretty fine even finish. So that's the Gesswein 1200 aluminium oxide stone. Right, now I'm going to move on to charcoal. This is the hon-zogan magnolia. I love a good piece of magnolia, and you'll see why in a moment, I hope. All right. As I said, you've got to select the right piece, but when you get your right piece, you know it cuts like nothing else. and it leaves an exquisite satin finish. It shows up all of the previous scratches if you haven't got them out. Remember, your polishing is a sequence of ever finer marks. And if you leave anything behind from the previous layer, it's going to show up right at the end. In fact, the paper that was done by Hallam University by an Irish chap whose name I can't pronounce, Patrick something, they did an analysis, scientific analysis, in as much as they could, of the various traditional polishing compounds and some various modern ones. And their interpretation of the results was interesting in as much as that it was flawed by the fact that they didn't know how to use the traditional materials properly. And what happened was they observed that as they used finer materials, they left scratches. It wasn't a matter of the finer materials leaving scratches. It was the fact that the previous stages hadn't been carried out sufficiently well, and that their technique had been too heavy-handed, and that the metal surface had been burnished to create the illusion of a fine finish. When they then proceeded to finer charcoal, it removed that burnish effect, revealing the scratches that were from the initial stages. And that's where you have a situation where people trying to do analytical work, scientific work, lacking the traditional training, understanding of the materials and the processes, are at a disadvantage and can very easily make inaccurate assumptions and assessments of things. So that was unlucky. Right, so that's Magnolia. As you can see, it's a beautifully soft satin finish, suitably fine. Right, and so the final piece of charcoal I am going to use is Paulownia. Paulownia is much softer and finer than the Magnolia charcoal, the hon-zogan. And I very rarely use it, except for gold and silver, really. It's very fine and has a very, very gentle effect. Paulownia is also used for polishing lacquer, as is hon-zogan, earlier stages. So when looking for some of these materials, online lacquer suppliers may be one source. Now, I'm doing everything in one direction. When you get down to these finer layers, it's normal, it's usual, to do very fine circular motions like that. But for the sake of consistency here and to allow you to compare, I'm going to leave a linear polishing pattern for you. Now, you can see it's actually done very little, because that's, of course, the as-rolled copper plate. It's such a gentle, fine finish. So it's obviously going to do very little on coarse metal. But I hope you can see it's cleaned a little. But you'd use this on that as a second stage. But it's a very, very fine finish. As you can see, it hasn't added any scratches. It's just very gentle. If you kept at it long enough, if you had nothing better to do, you would eventually get a very high finish. But of course, as I said, you'd use a stone, one of these three. Then you'd move to one of the charcoals. A synthetic Nagura, perhaps. And then, or a synthetic aluminium oxide stone. And then to Magnolia. And then to Paulownia. And then one last thing I want to try out for you, the slate pencil. I'll just show you what that can do. You've got to be careful that you don't get little bits of grit. I'm just going to do a little patch. It makes a slurry quite readily. You just got to be very careful that the tip doesn't crumble and you end up with bits of grit gouging out your copper. A light touch is all it takes. And again, you'd only be using this once you'd use, you know, coarser stones previously. This is a finishing stone. In this case, we're obviously going directly onto a as rolled bit of copper for comparative purposes. Again, you get the slurry building up and I can feel it catching. It's almost a sort of magnetic feeling. Okay. There we go. Not bad on copper. So that's not dissimilar in finish to Magnolia. It's a little coarser than the Magnolia. But actually, if you keep at it very carefully and very gently, you can get it ever so fine. Again, so what I'm doing here is I'm applying much less pressure and allowing the particles to break down more and more to make a finer finish. Now, this technique of becoming lighter and allowing the slurry to break down finer, which works well with natural stones, isn't really something you can do with synthetic stones. Well, certainly not very easily. And this is that sensitivity to material that's really important in traditional crafts, and why natural materials are important to us. That understanding of process, understanding what you're working with, is vital, really. Well, I'm not having much luck today getting a mirror finish on this piece of copper. You'll just have to take my word for it. That it is possible to get a very, very fine finish. Where I have used this is in the fine details on kogai, for example, in a recessed cartouche, or those tiny little twirly bits at the end, polishing those and keeping the form. I've used Scotch stone, and then I've used one of these to keep the shape. Just very delicately building up a slurry. But that's that. So there you have it, a range of possibilities. I just want to briefly touch on how to use stones on the ginkgo leaf. I don't intend to give you an exhaustive bit of film footage of me polishing the whole thing. And in episode 9C, I will be getting all messy and sloppy with some abrasive powders and water finishing up the ginkgo leaf. But for now, I just want to touch on, as I say, how to use the stone on the ginkgo leaf. Right. So I've got a little piece of Scotch stone for ease of use. It's just a square end, and you'll see how quickly it adapts. Now, I'm going to work at one flute. It's no good to work all over the place because your stone will never get a chance to form a suitable shape. And all you'll end up doing is working the most easily accessible areas and wearing your stone out unnecessarily. So we're going to work just this groove here for now. So I'm going to get my stone in there, and I'm just going to work a short distance. You can see I'm doing about 5 millimeter travel. And it's barely any pressure. I'm going to go a little bit further. I'm doing this just to check the overall shape. I'm moving down. All the while refining the tool tip for this particular groove. Now, wipe it off. Piece of tissue, a little cotton earbud is pretty good for these kind of things. I can see I've got a few marks over here in the curve here, so I'm going to concentrate on there. So it's just this very short action. You save the stone and you also help refine the form. So the trick is to do the hard to reach areas first. Do the tricky stuff first. Like the opposite of when you're at school. When you do all the easy stuff for homework and the really complicated stuff, you'd leave until 11 o'clock at night the night before. If you were like me. Actually, if you're like me, you didn't do it. Turned out okay in the end, though. So working like this on one flute at a time allows me to refine the form, keep my focus on one bit, I can see any irregularities, and I can just work away. So that's working in a groove. So working here, I've got to be careful not to touch the ground. So I try to get my stone on it and then see the mark I'm making. I'm trying to keep it in one place for Bella. She's going to shout at me if I move the focus. Try to get a little groove in the stone. Make a little groove, or maybe even file a little groove if you have to. So you've got a purchase and you can just come along safely. But it's just a matter of going very carefully and steadily, finding the best way to hold the piece, keep checking it against the light. And then, of course, you'd move on to charcoal. Now, it's exactly the same procedure with charcoal. But whereas before you were trying to get the stone to conform, your stone is significantly harder than the charcoal. If you try to force your charcoal into tiny areas, it's just going to crumble. So you really do have to be incredibly delicate in allowing the charcoal to find its way. You cannot force charcoal. Force charcoal is just dust and will do nothing for you. So you just have to work ever so carefully, work at a large area and then you work ever smaller, or if you've got a really nice form, find another piece of charcoal for the smaller bits. So you just keep that. And then right at the end, if you've got a tiny little area, say that you simply can't get into with a piece of charcoal, you can use a toothpick and you can pick up some of that slurry and work it in. The carbon will stick on the end of the toothpick, a piece of bamboo even, and you can just get in there with that and work away to refine your finish. So remember, that's always your final option. But in episode 9C, to follow, we're going to talk about the use of abrasive powders in finishing work. But I think that is enough for now. I hope that's shed some light on how we go about polishing using stones and giving you some ideas for alternatives where you are. I'll see you in the next episode. Thanks for watching. Cheers.